Gathered here, and it's good, and God offers us grace. This grace isn't just for me, it's for you, it's for all of us. I just want to just call us to a verse in Ephesians that just talks about this grace. God saved you by his grace when you believed. All we have to do is believe. And you can't take credit for it. This is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we've done, so none of us can boast about it. For we are God's masterpiece. He created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do good things he planned for us long ago. I just invite you right now to stand, and I just want to repeat this. Have you join me and repeat this last line. So go ahead and stand. You are God's masterpiece. We all are. So I invite you to just read this screen with us together. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us. God knew you'd be here today. God knows your heart. God knows your longings. He knows your hurt. And God loves you. I pray that you experience that today in some way through a touch, through a word, through a song, that God indeed loves you. As we continue this morning, we earnestly seek after God.
Lord, I am full. Good morning. I too want to welcome you to Clinton Frame as we have God's people gathered together this morning to praise and worship God. We believe that God has led you here this morning, and we are so happy that you have joined us this morning. If you are a visitor with us this morning, let's try that again. If you are a visitor with us this morning, you should have gotten a green card either in your welcome packet or there might be one in the pew in front of you. If you want to fill that out, that way we can kind of get to know you a little bit better, and in that welcome pack, there should be some information that you can get to know us a little bit better as well. If you want to drop that in the offering basket, or you can go ahead and return it out to the Welcome Center, which is this little mobile cart in our foyer, that would be fantastic. As we move to a time of prayer, a couple of prayer updates. Please continue to be in prayer for Ruby Duvall. Ruby had surgery this last week. Then please be in prayer for Mary Ellen Mast, who was hospitalized this last week. And then continue to pray for Rachel Miller as well. Rachel is going to the ER this morning, so please remember her and Al and the rest of the family in your prayers. Then as well, we want to, now Bob and Trish aren't here this morning. They are down in Indianapolis with their children, but we want to congratulate them yesterday morning. Jordan and Kate had their baby, Wesley Jack, which is 8 pounds, 10 ounces, and so we rejoice with them, and we celebrate with them this morning. At this time, if there is anyone in need of prayer this morning, we invite you to stand, and if you remain standing, those around you will lay hands on you for prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you dwell with us each and every day, that your Spirit lives within us, that you daily give us comfort that we need to make it through one more day. Father God, I pray for those who have been in the hospital or who are still in the hospital for various reasons. Father, I pray that your hand of healing would be upon them. Father, we pray for Ruby, for Mary Ellen, for Rachel. Father, may you give them strength. May you be with doctors and nurses to give them wisdom to know what needs to be done to help them fully recuperate. Father, we thank you as well for new life. Father, we pray for Jordan and Kate, especially as they prepare to go back on the mission field in a few months. Father, I pray that you would bless Wesley. We pray that you would be with Jordan and Kate and Bob and Sue and Bob and Trish and the rest of the parents or the grandparents and family as they raise this child together. I pray that you would help them to raise him in the Lord. Give them the wisdom to know what needs to be done, that he too might grow in his love for you. Father, we pray for those who are standing here this morning. We pray that you would give them wisdom and guidance. Father, whatever they're going through this next week, may your Spirit dwell with them and upon them. Give them exactly what they need to get through. And we just ask all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. A couple of announcements this morning. Just want to remind you of Harvest Sunday, which is next week. We'll be having our normal time of food, Thanksgiving dinner. And that will, of course, be a MYF's fundraiser as well. But during this time, we also bring food donations in. So if you have food donations that are not yet expired, but still good, we invite you to bring those in and share those with those who are in need. As well, we want to remind you that the Noah's Ark Party is Saturday from 5:30 to 7:30. Just pray as well that this would be a safe environment, a pleasant environment for kids to come to have fun, to fellowship, get lots of candy and toy and all that kind of stuff as well. And then we also want to make you aware of the time of your life concert that will be happening. Now, this is next March, but tickets go on sale this week. So if you're interested in buying tickets for this, now the March 11th, 2016 is when the tickets are, or the concert are. This is not a good morning for me, folks. If you're interested in coming to this awesome concert, and I believe that it will be a really good concert, and we are looking forward to it here. Tickets go on sale this week. You can either go to itickets.com, or we will also have a link to it on our website starting Wednesday at 10 a.m. So at this time, we invite the children up. So
it's good to see you all here this morning. It's been a long time, it seems, since we've been together up front. Why don't you come on this side, Amber? And come over here. All right. I have a picture of something here this morning. Who can tell me what this is?
Sign.
All right. What is it?
Sign.
It's a sign, yeah. What else is it? It's a welcome mat. Anybody have a mat in front of their door that says welcome? You do? Here, a couple of you do. I went out and looked, and you know what? I got a mat in front of my door, and it does not say welcome. All right, I've got some that say Merry Christmas and some other ones, but I don't know why I don't have one that says welcome. But it's a welcome mat. And why do we have this in front of our house? Why do we have this in front of the door? Oh, here, go ahead, Isabella.
Because it's welcome people to your house.
Welcome people to your house. And your mom and dad will probably say, because I said this to my kids, wipe your feet, all right? We're going into this house, wipe your feet, and hey, we're glad you're here. And you know what? We, at our house, we have a little window about this wide. It goes all the way down. And when my kids were little and we were expecting someone, they'd stand there and watch. Okay, you know who watches there now? My dog. And I can tell, even just nothing has to happen. All I got to do is I see her, she runs down, her goes to the window, looks, and the tail starts wagging. Okay? She's saying, I am glad you are here, because she loves kids particularly. All right? A welcome mat says, hey, we are just glad that you are here. And come on in, all right? Now, do you ever do that when friends are coming over? You're waiting for them, right? And when they come, you don't just stand there. You say, come on in, because we want to welcome. Well, here at church, when new people come here, they come. We have greeters at the doors, okay? And the greeters are like the people that say, hey, come on in. We're glad that you are here. And then we help them come to the Welcome Center, the little round small one. And that's the place where our guests come. And they get a bag like this, all right? And now, this is our welcome mat, okay? This is the stuff that says, boy, I'm glad you're here. Hey, okay, so if you see someone with a bag like this, you know that they are new here. They're one of our guests. Well, let me show you what's in here. Some of it's not really that exciting, okay? Adults would find this more interesting, all right? One of the things that's in there is a coupon. Okay? They can go to the coffee shop over here and have free drinks, like coffee and water and tea and that kind of stuff. So say, yeah, go there. You don't have to pay this time. You get a something for that. Then we have this folder, and it tells all kinds of stuff. It's got pictures of the pastors over here. It's actually some of you. Huh? I see Drew there. I see Lindley there. Pictures of kids. And it's going to say the thing, different things that we do here in church. Because when people are new here, they don't know where things are. They don't know what we all do here. They know that we get together here and worship. But outside of worship, they probably don't know much. And so we're trying to help them be welcome. Like, come on in. This is what we do here. Now, if they have kids, then we put something else in the bag, okay? And this is only if there's kids, okay? Grown-ups do not get this, all right? So we give them a coloring book, all right? This one says Jesus, the Holy Spirit, and me. And it's got some cool stuff to color, and it tells the kids about Jesus, all right? So we get a coloring book. Now, what do you need if you have a coloring book?
Coloring.
You need to color it, so you need to get some crayons, right? So there's some crayons in there, and I'll tell you what. If they got three kids, we'll do three coloring books and three crayons so you don't have to fight and share on Sunday morning, okay? Just makes it easier. And there's something else in here. Anybody know what these are? Fruit snacks. Why do you think we put fruit snacks in a welcome bag? Huh? So people can eat them, because sometimes kids get hungry, don't they? Kids just get hungry. And so we have some fruit snacks in there in case they get hungry, because mom and dad might not know how long church goes or when we get out. When my kids were little, I sometimes brought a snack for them, because sometimes you just get hungry in church, all right? And you know what kids who are new here don't know? They don't know where to get suckers, okay? Where do you guys go to get suckers?
Office.
The office, okay? And if some of you newer kids don't know where to get suckers, you just go to the office. And so in between church and Sunday school, if you see a grown-up with a bag like this, and you see kids there, you're going to say, hey, hi, I'm glad you're here. Do you want me to get you a sucker, or you want to come with me? I'll show you where the suckers are, all right? Some of you new folks, make sure you figure out where the suckers are, okay? That's one way we show hospitality, is we help people feel welcome here, all right? And we show them around. If someone's in your Sunday school class or goes to opening time when we sing together, hi, my name is Linda. I'm glad you're here. Do you want to sit with me? Okay, that's ways we show hospitality. It says, I'm glad you're here. Right? So that's what these bright green bags are all about. If you see someone who's got one of these, this is their first time here, look for kids. Okay, look for the kids that are with them and say, hey, I got a secret. It's where we get suckers. And I am so glad you are here. All right? So, Caden.
In order to get two other candies.
Pardon me?
In order to get two other candies.
You know where to get two other candies, too. And I'm not going to bring those people, okay? I just want you to know that there are people in this church that have other forms of candy in big purses. And if you're not sure who they are, just stand out here and watch. And you'll see where the kids run, okay? Sometimes gum is given out too, and you probably know who that is too. If you don't, just watch who's handing out gum. These are ways in which we show hospitality, which we say, I'm glad you're here. And you know, the very first Sunday we were here, Squeaky gave my son a pack of gum, and he thought, wow, someone noticed that I was new here. All right? So notice, look for the green bags, and especially if there are kids around, and you'll see this poking out because it doesn't fit. You'll know that those kids are new, and you can say, welcome, I'm glad you're here, all right? So this is our welcome bag. It's like a welcome mat. It's glad you're here. Come on in, all right? Thanks, kids. Come on forward. I think my mic got turned off too soon. Special time of worship for us when we give back to God what he's given to us. Let's pray. I thank you, God, for your many gifts. I thank you that we can gather as your people here, as a community, as a family, because we love you, we worship you, and we give back some of our gifts to you as we give this offering. Thank you, God, for blessing us. In your name we pray. Amen.
See me. The ending of that song, that God is forever mine. We often talk about that we belong to God. It's not very often that we talk in terms of God belonging to us. In Psalm 73, and it's an amazing psalm of God's presence, and it ends with that. You're the strength of my heart. You are mine forever. By the way, I've noticed that the clock up there says 10:04. So settle in. I got a lot of time this morning. Someone may change that before we get going. We're going through this series about what we believe, and this morning we're focusing on what do we believe about families and marriages, relationships. Relationships in the home and relationships in the church. And the word that I want us to really think about this morning is the word intimacy. Where do we experience intimacy in our marriages, in our families, and in the church? Now, I know from the world's point of view, when we talk about intimacy, usually from the world's point of view, it is about sexual expression and relationships. And as the world portrays it often in that setting, the physical intimacy, I think it's just the very opposite of what true intimacy is. Because true intimacy is not about meeting my needs through another person. But intimacy is a sense of oneness, of me meeting the other's need. Last week, Keith Weaver said that he believes there are many, many ways that we find intimacy. And that in the church, we should be all about deepening friendships, deepening relationships, having life-filling, meaningful relationships. And how do we do that? In our marriages, our homes, and within the congregation. If we go back to creation, in the very beginning. And if you read through the creation story, it says there were 6 days where God created the earth, and every time it says, God says, this is good. But if you read through the creation story, there's one point where God says, this is not good. It's not good. God created a man, and he put him in this beautiful garden. And from our point of view, we would say Adam had everything he could possibly want. He had an ideal life. He lived in this beautiful garden. There was no pollution. There was no traffic. There was no disease. He had everything he wanted. He didn't have to worry about food or clothing. He didn't have to pay the bills. How could you get a better life than what Adam had? And yet God looked down at Adam and he said, it's not good. Something is missing. What was missing? Adam was alone. In Genesis 2:18, the Lord God said, it's not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. I read this week of a little girl that came home from Sunday school class. She told her mom that this morning the Sunday school teacher told them that God created man first, and he was very lonely. So the man fell into a sleep, and God took his brains and created a woman. So I guess now we know why we have this imbalance. God said it's not good for man to be alone. And so he created a woman. We see helper, a helper that is suitable for him. And I think sometimes in our context, we really miss what the Hebrew word meant. It was really more the sense of a rescuer, of a savior. It comes from a position of strength. I think sometimes when we see, well, God created woman as a helper, we think, well, you know, she's my helpmate. She's going to help me. But it really is a sense of equality, of rescuing and saving each other, of being in this deep, intimate relationship that is life-giving and provides both of them strength and hope. In the Confession of Faith, it states that marriage is to be between one man and one woman for life. A relationship that is based on equality and love. That physical intimacy is to be expressed only within the covenant of marriage, and marriage is to be a commitment for life. That is what we believe. A relationship that is built, I believe, on mutual submission. And I believe that there are many images, there are many places in the New Testament that brings this to the forefront. In Ephesians 5, beginning with verse 21, and it's the verse that is often talked about when we think about marriages, and it begins with this statement, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Submit to each other. How is that possible? From the way the world looks at submission, that absolutely is not possible. It is only possible if one has first submitted their life to Jesus. But if we have submitted our lives to Jesus completely, then we are willing and able to submit to each other out of love. In Ephesians 5, it continues, for wives, this means submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of his wife, just as Christ is the head of the church. He is the Savior of his body, the church. As the church submits to Christ, so you wives should submit to your husband in everything. For husbands, this means love your wives as Christ loved the church. He gave up his life for her. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as they love their own bodies. For a man who loves his wife actually shows love for himself. No one hates his own body but feeds it and cares for it, just as Christ cares for the church. And we are members of his bodies. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, and it is an illustration of Christ and the church and the oneness they have. So again, I say, each man must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. And I don't want to get into this to any detail this morning because I want to go on with intimacy. But I will say that sometimes in the church I hear men saying, well, my wife isn't submitting to me, or I'm in charge, and that kind of language. But they certainly aren't fulfilling the other part of this passage of loving their wife as Christ loved the church and being willing to give himself up for her. It is in with that deep sense of submitting to each other, of loving each other that much, that true intimacy happens. Paul speaks again of this mutuality in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, and this is verse 4, but he's talking about physical intimacy, and he says, the wife gives authority over her body to her husband. And when Paul said that, everybody in the church in that culture said, preach it, Brother Paul, that's exactly right. The wife gives authority over her body to her husband. The next sentence would have completely and totally blown them away. They'd have said, Paul, what are you thinking about? And the husband gives authority over his body to his wife. It's a mutual thing. I shared that with Matt this morning. I said, did you know that Liz has authority over your body? And he said, well, that's why I'm letting my hair grow back. So thank you, Liz. In this text, then, Paul goes on to talk about singleness in the church. And he lifts singleness, being single, living a life in that state of being single to a high level. And what he's really doing is he's affirming and appreciating everyone who is a part of the church. Intimacy. Intimacy is never about me, but it is about the other. Intimacy comes when we experience unconditional love, the kind of love that Jesus taught us, the kind of love that we see over and over again in the New Testament. And in almost all these passages, when Paul writes about it, he's writing about loving each other in the church. In Galatians chapter 5, he says, y'all been called to freedom, but don't use your freedom for your own selfish indulgence, but through love serve each other. As brothers and sisters in Christ, we are called to serve each other. He says that we are to love our neighbor as much as we love ourselves. And a few sentences later, he says, we are to carry each other's burdens. And as we carry each other's burdens, we will fulfill the law of Christ. That is the kind of intimacy, that is the kind of relationship that Paul is calling for us to experience in the church. But I often say, the best place to begin to practice that is in our homes. Because if we don't experience that kind of love, And that kind of intimacy in our marriages and our homes, I don't believe we're able to experience it in the church. The kind of warmth and stability and peace and intimacy that God desires for all of our relationships. How we treat each other matters. It's important. Paul goes on and he talks about singles. And quite frankly, quite honestly, I believe that in the church we often fall short. That often in the church we're pretty focused on couples and families. And sometimes single people feel lost. Where do they belong in the church? Some people are single because they've chosen to be single. Some are single because they've never met the right person to enter into a covenant of marriage. Some are single through loss of a spouse, through death or divorce. How do we in the church create a space, a safe place where all persons' needs are met? And I'd ask Daryl King to come forward. I've asked Daryl if he would share with us this morning some of his experience here at Clinton Frame. He's a part of a small group that's been really important to you, and I just ask you to share a little bit about what it's like to be a part of that small group that is all couples, and you as a single person. How has that worked, and how has that affected your life? And you'll need to hold this close.
Okay. Like this?
Like that.
I guess first and foremost, a little bit of background. Some of this will be regarding my dad passed away 2 years ago next month. And that what I'm going to be talking about a little bit kind of plays into that, so I'll give you some background about that. Small group there, I am the only single person there. But they allow me, my job, I start very early in the morning. I get up at about 3:40. And sometimes small groups, it starts at 6:30 and goes till maybe 9 or 9:15. And I just made the decision that I need to leave about halfway through so I can get home and get a decent night's sleep. And they allow me to do that. They never joke about that. You know, Daryl's going to leave now. And when I get up to leave to go home, they wish me well, you know, safe drive home. And so that's a comforting feeling. And a little bit, sometimes now that I don't have any parents, sometimes there's some major questions or major life decisions that all, it's just nice to have a sounding board, some people that I can bounce ideas off of, so I'll call them and say, hey, well, you know, what do you think about this? What do you think I should do? And then they give me guidance on that. One more thing about the small group too, after my father died, there was a lady in the small group that she sent me texts, maybe every 3 or 4 weeks. It was just simple things like, you know, we're praying for you today, God loves you, hope you have a fabulous day, but it was very effective. And I have saved those texts, and in the last year and a half when things were kind of low, I would pull those texts up on my phone and say, hey, somebody cares about me. So that made me feel welcome.
You've talked some about it. As you're going through this time of grief the last 2 years, I know it's not only been your small group, but also your Sunday school class that has reached out to you.
Mm-hmm.
What was most important in that as a single person that you received, you think, in the support that you received?
A lot of people just shared right after he died. I had numerous invitations to go out to eat. And just to, you know, say talk or what, you know, just they were reaching out to me, and that is still happening, and that's just, it's nice that, because most of my life now is alone, I don't have a, you know, and that provides me with a social contact that I can, you know, get to know the people on a more personal level.
Thank you, Daryl. In the church, No one should ever feel alone. And you talked about aloneness. And it doesn't just go one way, Daryl. It's not just what the small group and Sunday school class has done for you. Yesterday I received a text from someone in your small group who you had said you'd called them and told them you were talking today and you needed prayer. And it was a long text that this person sent me of how you have touched their life in very specific ways. And so I know it isn't just a one-way street. But I think for us as a church, we need to continually work at and think about how do we include each other? We are not created to be alone. It is not good to be alone. We are created for relationship. And for those who do not have marriages and families, how do we help them to find that in the church? To create intimacy. And I want this morning just to look at a few things of how we create intimacy. And the first one is, it requires time. And I know you're sitting there and you're saying, duh, we already knew that. We all knew that it takes time to create intimacy. Intimacy. And yet, I believe that it has become one of the greatest challenges that we have today at all levels, marriages, family, and home. It's our greatest challenge. One of the things that I hear sometimes, and this was already a reality when we had small children, and we would talk about quality time. We need just some quality time with our kids. And usually we would think about it in terms of, well, we don't have much time, so when we have time, it needs to be quality. And I agree that we need quality time, but I think even more important than quality is quantity. We need time with our children. This is true with our relationship with God. We will not have a meaningful, life-giving relationship with God unless we spend time reading our Bibles, in prayer, in meditation, in reflection, unless we spend time connecting with God. And in our marriages, this must be a priority, and I know it's not easy. When we had small children, I think in some ways that took a toll on us in our marriage relationship. And much of it had to do, we just didn't have the time that we needed to be together. I think it's something that the church needs to do for young families. That somehow I have this vision and this dream of being a congregation where young families can come and just find rest and support and restoration. One way that we can do that, and you know, during child dedication, we always say that we're going to be there to help you raise this child. Those of us who have raised our children can be Sunday school teachers. We can be in the nursery so that when our young families come, our young couples can gather together for support and encouragement. They can sit in through the worship service with someone else providing a safe, caring place for their children that helps them to learn about Jesus. But I think as a congregation and as a church, we need to be mindful of that and support our marriages and the time that they need with each other. To create intimacy requires communication, and I know that's another duh. Really? We have to talk with each other? But what I really want us to focus on is intimacy only comes when we listen. Communication doesn't start with my mouth, it starts with my ears. And communication actually goes much deeper than that, because I not only need to listen with my ears, I also have to listen with my heart. And try to feel the feelings of the other person. It's not easy to do. In order to do it, I have to be quiet and listen. I got a really clear lesson in this about 18 years ago. Julie and I were at a marriage retreat, and an assignment they gave us, and when they gave it to me, I went, oh no. We had to go outside, find a quiet place to sit down and talk with each other. But the rule was this. One was going to talk for 10 minutes and the other person sit in silence, and then we would switch. 10 minutes in silence, listening. Well, I was glad that she went first because I didn't know how I was going to ever fill up 10 minutes. But she began to talk. And I listened. And she immediately began to talk about how I wasn't willing to get serious about my health. At that point, I was having a lot of acid reflux and throat issues. Whenever she had talked about that before, I would always change the subject. Or I would make some stupid joke. I would do anything I could to deflect it. But I had to sit quietly and listen. And as I listened, I began to hear her fear. It was the first time I ever heard that. She was afraid for my health. And the interesting thing was, when she finally got done, and I think she took the whole 10 minutes, she said, "I've said it, and I will never say it again." You know, one of the cruel things that sometimes men say about their wives is that they nag them. Maybe the reason they stay after us is because we're not listening and hearing. She was satisfied. It's up to you now. I'm not going to ever say it again. And Monday morning, I called the doctor, and we started setting up appointments that led to a surgery that was successful and led to good health. And I've often wondered about that exercise. Why did it take something like that to get me to just shut up and listen? But it did. I've actually encouraged other couples to do that because I think it's a very good way to hear each other. In order to have intimacy with God, it requires that we listen closely. I love that story of Elijah where he's on the mountain and God says, "I'm going to come." And so there's this great wind, and then there's this great earthquake, and then there's this great fire. And Elijah is expecting God to show up in one of those things, the wind, the earthquake, or the fire. And after that, he hears a gentle whisper. He hears a still, small voice. I think sometimes we expect God to speak to us in great, miraculous ways, and we're not willing to just sit quietly and listen. To listen to that gentle whisper from God. Intimacy is developed through meaningful, healthy touch. And actually, I believe that in our culture today, this is a difficult one for us. Because we're careful how we touch, and we need to be careful. Because many people, even in the church, have experienced unhealthy touch and abuse through touch. And yet we need meaningful, healthy touch in our marriages, in our families, and in our church. We were part of a small house church in Wichita, Kansas, many years ago, and there was this wonderful lady named Abby who was 90 years old. Her husband had been gone for years. She came to church so that she could get hugs. And she would openly say that. This is the only place, she said, when she can receive healthy, meaningful touch. I just think that as a congregation, we need to continually look at ways that we can do this. I understand what she meant. I understand what she was feeling. We know that as infants, they won't thrive unless they have touch. And I think that's true for us throughout our adult life. And finally, building intimacy requires to explore spiritual terrain together. There is something about our spiritual lives that makes us feel vulnerable. I've never exactly been able to figure that out, but I know it's true. It's hard for us to share with each other exactly what is going on in our lives spiritually, of how we are experiencing God, of how we're walking in spiritual darkness. And yet, I think it is the deepest form of genuine intimacy to be able to share with each other. When two people have a spiritual hunger or spiritual awareness in common, they become soulmates. In other words, spiritually is the soul of marriage. Without spiritual roots, couples are left with an emptiness and a superficiality that prevents genuine intimacy. Spirituality leads to genuine intimacy. And one of the things that I've heard from many people who I've talked to who've gone through divorce, and one of the things that is common is they'll say, you know, we were never as close as I thought we would be. We never had this sense of oneness that I longed for. Sometimes they will use the word soulmates. We were never soulmates. But somehow they had never experienced this God in their lives. And I just encourage us as couples, as families, and with each other, to be open to praying for each other, to be open to just expressing, this is what I'm struggling with in my spiritual life, or this is how I'm experiencing God. As a couple, as a married couple, how is God real in your life? As a couple, how do you experience God? What is God's purpose for you? What are the joys? Thank God for the joys in those mountaintop experiences. And thank God that he is present with you in the darkest of times. One of those times for me that was really special was our second trip to Washington, D.C. 3 years ago, we were heading out to begin this treatment for Lyme's disease. And as often was the case, Julie was driving and I was sleeping. That's how we always went. And it was in the night, and it was late, and I woke up, and I heard the song on that she was playing. It was a CD, and the song was Healing Rain is Falling Down. Healing rain is falling down. Faith is rising. And she told me that she had been playing and replaying that song. And she just felt like this is the beginning of God pouring down healing rain. That moment, I loved her. Because she was sharing with me her hope for what God had for us as a couple. We need to be able to share those times together. As we experience our spiritual lives together, we become much larger and greater than we could ever do it alone. One pastor once said, sorry, I went too quick. One pastor said that when he and his wife were married, they knew that they were to become one flesh. And for 10 years, they fought about which one they were going to become. The truth is that within a marriage, the one who emerges, it's not the denial of our individuality or our uniqueness. It's not about merging our separate selves together. But the mystery is, the Apostle Paul in Ephesians 5, he talked about this great mystery. The mystery is that in the union with another one before God, we are a part of creating something much larger than ourselves, a oneness that is new and profoundly more than anything we could ever become alone. Becoming something much greater than we could ever be alone. And we know that is true in the church. We know that that is true in the body of Christ. That as we give ourselves to each other, we become much greater than anything that we could ever do on our own. We need each other. And so I just encourage us as a congregation to look for those ways in our marriages, in our families, and right here at church, that we can meaningfully reach out to each other in the oneness that God calls us to. I love this phrase. Love is made up of 1,000 little daily choices to live in and express God's love. Love and intimacy doesn't happen by chance. Love is not some feeling that we have. Love is a choice. It's a choice that we make in thousand little ways to live and express God's love. We're going to end the service with a video. Anita sent this video to me yesterday afternoon, and I love this video because there are so many pictures in this video of intimacy. There is intimacy between couples. There is intimacy within families. There's intimacy in church settings. So many ways that you will see people reaching out, making that choice. Making that choice to be Jesus to another. The main line says, Jesus, help us carry you. Alive in us, your light shines through. And every act of love, we bring the kingdom. Every act of love, we bring God's kingdom to this earth as we touch others.
Stoplight, you can't be bothered by the heart cry written on the cardboard in her hands. Oh, but when she looks him in the eye, his heart is broken open wide, and he feels the hand of God reach out through him. As heaven touches her, kingdom come, oh, 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 oh. With every act of love, Jesus, help us carry you. Alive in us, your light shines through. With every act of love, we bring the kingdom come. There's silence at the table. He wants to talk, but he's not able, for all the shame that's locked in deep inside. Oh, but her words are the medicine, when she says they can begin again, and forgiveness will set him free tonight. As heaven touches her, oh, 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 we bring the kingdom come. One of those doors is you. I said, God put a million, million doors in the world for his love to walk through. One of those doors is you.
Stand for prayer. And I invite the prayer team to come forward and to be here. And if anyone would like prayer after the service, feel free to come forward and someone will pray with you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you have created us with this need for relationships. And we thank you that you have given your church this responsibility of carrying your love. Father, I pray that you will just touch our hearts, that you will break our hearts with the needs that we see in our marriages, in our families, and in our church, and to others that we meet. Break our hearts in a way that we are able to meaningfully reach out and just to give acts of love and kindness that brings you into people's lives. Father, I pray that you will build strong relationships at all levels within this body here. In Jesus' name, we pray.